Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another subject about ancient Egypt. And tonight's subject will be about mummification in ancient Egypt, how and why. For the majority of peoples, Egyptology is the study of a dead civilization. But for a sufficiently large minority, Egyptology is a means of rediscovering wisdom as well as a means of progressing towards a knowledge that today's advanced, highly advanced science does not bring. To talk about Egypt is to talk about an inexhaustible subject that conceals many mysteries and unknowns. One of these is mummification, that is the mysterious science of ancient Egypt. The term mummy appeared in the Latin language for the first time about 1000 AD and was applied to the body of a human being, animal, bird, fish, or reptile, which has been preserved by means of bitumen, spices, gums, or natron. The word mummy has neither an ancient Egyptian nor Coptic origin. The hieroglyphic word for mummy in ancient Egypt was sa, and the word used to indicate the act of making a dead man into a mummy is wet, W-T, which means to wrap up in bandages. The word mummy is derived from the Persian word moma, M-O-M-A, which means bitumen or pitch. It is also derived from the Arabic word momia, M-O-M-Y-A, which means bituminized body, that is a body preserved by bitumen. In reality, the Egyptians did not use bitumen during the process of mummification. The Egyptian custom of mummification was a legacy of Atlantean culture. And mummification of the dead among the late Atlanteans was widely and extensively practiced. Many ancient civilizations practiced mummification, such as the Chimos in Peru, who were the successors of the Incas, the Aztecs in Mexico, under the influence of the Mayas, the Guanches in Canary Islands, who were the last of the Atlanteans, the Chinese, the Tibetans, even today, the saint in Tibet are mummified. In Egypt, mummification rites were first applied only to the pharaohs. The pharaoh was the perfect one at the highest level that a man can reach or be born into, that is king of Egypt and the high priest of the land. The initiate king wore the cobra on his forehead, sign of royalty and wisdom. He was the royal initiate. With the decadence of Egyptian religion, a time came when mummification was applied to nobility and to anyone who could afford the cost of the process. So great did the vogue become that at one time, even animals were mummified. Herodotus, the Greek historian in the 5th century BC, who spent 20 years in Egypt, gives us the following account. There was a set of men called the embalmers, whose profession was hereditary. They were professionals both in physical and spiritual spheres, and were worth of every honor and respect. They were associated with the priests and were admitted to the temples without hindrance as holy men ceremonially pure. How was mummification done? The most perfect embalming consisted first by means of an iron hook. They drew out the brain through the nostrils without breaking or injuring the bridge of the nose. They took out the brain partly in this manner and partly by the infusion of drugs to ensure that the internal cavity was completely coated. Heated resin was poured, thus killing any bacteria and forming an airtight seal and preserving the soft tissues. Then stuffing the cranial cavity with myrrh, cinnamon, cassia, etc. In no case was the brain preserved with the other organs, probably because the ancient Egyptians did not assign to the brain any special or important function. To the Egyptians, the heart, and not the brain, was the seat of mind and emotion. With a sharp Ethiopian stone, they made a cut on the left side of the abdomen and removed all the contents, except the kidneys. The abdomen was then cleansed, rinsed with palm wine, and rinsed again with powdered aromatics. After the abdomen was cleansed, the diaphragm was cut, and all the contents of the chest cavity were removed, except the heart. The heart was considered to be the organ that recorded all the good and evil deeds the deceased did during his life. And in religious scenes, the heart was worthy of heaven or not. The heart, therefore, had to be kept with the body for the funeral ceremony. The chest cavity was then cleansed in the same way as the abdomen. Then the internal cavities of the chest and the abdomen were coated with hot resin, as done with the cranial cavity. Then filled with pure powdered myrrh, cinnamon, and cassia, and every other kind of spicery except frankincense. Then they sewed it up again. As mentioned, the contents of the skull, abdomen, and chest were removed, now washed and placed in a container of natron for 40 days. After being sprinkled with perfume and treated with hot resin, they were wrapped in packages and placed in four jars. The embalmment required 70 days, as stated by Herodotus. Almost half that time was required for dehydration. Since any remaining fluids would have meant decomposition to the body. The body, to be preserved, had to be dehydrated. The substance called natron, N-A-T-R-O-N, was used to promote this dehydration or desiccation process. This dehydration or desiccation process was done by placing the body on a sloping board and covering it with heaps of dried natron for 40 days. This substance, natron, was called by the ancient Egyptian neterit, from which the Greek word nitron and the chemical symbol for sodium or natrium or Na are derived. Natron is a naturally occurring substance composed mainly of sodium carbonate, sodium bicarbonate, and a low percentage of sodium chloride and sodium sulfate. Natron is found abundantly mainly in Wadi Natrun, 40 kilometers west of Cairo. So after 40 days of dehydration, the body was rubbed with a mixture of cedar oil, cumin, cinnamon, sweet-smelling drugs, gum, wax, and possibly milk and wine, then dusted with spices. In the Bible, in the book of Genesis, chapter 50, we read the following. Joseph commended his servants, the physicians, to embalm his father. So the physicians embalmed Israel. 40 days were required for it, for so many days are required for embalming. And the Egyptians wept for him 70 days, unquote. Another quotation from the Bible, the same chapter. So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt, unquote. Even today, a ceremony for the dead is conducted 40 days after death, perhaps a form of this early tradition of 40 days of desiccation or embalmment. To restore a lifelike appearance to the face, the cheeks were padded with linen and the nose was plugged. Small pads of linen were placed in the sockets and the eyelids were closed. The embalmers achieved such a completeness and perfection in their work that the eyelashes and eyebrows remained uninjured. And its form was so little changed that today it is easy to recognize the features. To strengthen the skin and to prevent moisture from entering the pores, a thick coating of molten resin was applied to the entire body. Amulets and jewelry were then used to decorate and protect the body, and bandaging began by separately wrapping each finger and toe, then each limb, and finally the body as a whole. We read in Isis Unveiled the following, quote, "It is in the process of preparing mummies that the skill of this wonderful people is exemplified in the highest degree. None but those who have made special study of the subject can estimate the amount of skill, patience, and knowledge exacted for the accomplishment of this indestructible work, which occupied several months. Both chemistry and surgery were called into requisition," unquote. So let us see some of the mummies. Modern drawing of the house of embalmment, which was called Per Nefer or Wabet, showing the wrapping up of a mummy with bandages. A priest wearing Anubis mask performs the words of power over the sarcophagus in which lies the mummy. Open coffin showing a perfectly bandaged mummy. A well-preserved mummy at the British Museum showing part of the bandages of the chest and arms. Thutmose I, 18th dynasty, 15th century BC, one of the well-preserved of the royal mummies. Mummy of a priestess of Amun. Yuya, 14th century BC, father of Ti, who was the wife of Amenhotep III, and Amenhotep III was the father of Akhenaten. And this is also one of the best preserved mummies in Egyptian museum. Has long flaxen hair. Mummy of a woman suggested to be Queen Hatshepsut, 18th dynasty. Tutankhamun's embalmed face, 18th dynasty, 13th century BC. Deterioration of the face is due to excessive addition of oils, destined to give it new vitality, but it did the opposite. Seti I, 19th dynasty, 13th century BC, is the most lifelike appearance of those great pharaohs. He even has a smile on his face because of its excellent preservation and distinctiveness of the facial features. Seti I's face can be compared with a relief on the temple of Abydos. The result is a striking resemblance. Ramesses II, 19th dynasty, 13th century BC, was almost 90 when he died. The lateral x-rays showed the aging process and extensive dental wear. Merimptah, 19th dynasty, 12th century BC, son of Ramesses II, is of special interest because of the discoloration of the skin caused by salts. Early writers speculated that this occurred because the pharaoh drowned in the sea during the Exodus. But this is not true, as x-ray and examination of the chest show no evidence of drownedness. The process of mummification at that time often produced such discoloration. Like his father, he suffered greatly from dental problems. Most of his back teeth were missing. Ramesses III, 11th century BC. The well-preserved mummy of Ramesses III has provided the model of innumerable horror films. It is especially interesting because of the packing of the eye sockets and the pierced ears, which was a common attribute of Egyptian kings. Ramesses V, 11th century BC, another well-preserved royal mummy. Another well-preserved royal mummy of Queen Hentowi, 21st dynasty, 11th century BC. Excessive packing of the face to restore a lifelike appearance has caused the skin to burst. Now the big question, why was mummification performed? Before we search for the answer to this question, we have to know man's constitution, visible and invisible. According to the ancient Egyptians, man is a trinity of spirit, soul, and body. The body of man is composed of, first, the ghat was called the ghat, which is the physical, visible part. The second, the khabit, which is the etheric body, or the shadow of man. In science, it represents the electrical body around our physical being. And today, whatever these people said many thousand years ago, now science has proved. We see here the etheric body around the physical. The etheric body is also called the vital body, as it keeps the human body in equilibrium and healthy. Any deterioration or injury to the etheric body will cause a subsequent deterioration of the physical at the same site. This electrical body, is considered to be the phantom or the shadow. It was represented in ancient Egypt as an elongated and disproportionate shadow of a man. In certain circumstances, the shadow of a recently deceased person can become visible to certain people. In the majority of cases, where an apparition occurs of one who has recently passed away, it is this etheric body that becomes visible to the human eye. Then we come to the third part of the body, is the ka, K-A, known in Egyptology as a man's double, and explained by Wallace Budge as being man's abstract individuality or personality, or what we can call self, little s, small s. It has an absolutely independent existence and can move freely from place to place, separating itself from or uniting itself to the body at will, and was symbolized as two upstretched arms. The ka can approximate the aura or the astral body. I explained this in length in one of my previous lectures about the man's constitution, visible and invisible. But I'm trying to make it in an abbreviated form tonight. So it approximates, the ka approximates the aura or the astral body, the body of emotion, desire, feeling, and wishes, and resembles the physical body. Let us not forget that the astral body has the memory of all that happened to man on earth. This memory is like a recording on film or on tape. In our subconscious, the ka, or the astral body, or the double, is a dynamic, invisible body, active both day and night. When we sleep, it stays awake, moves, travels, speaks, gives messages, meets other people's ka, and defends our interests. It even travels ahead to the future. In other words, it is an entity that thinks, lives, and feels independently. Controlling our ka, our astral body, during our life, means controlling our desires, our emotion, our feelings, thus purifying our aura, purifying our ka. The ka is born with us, or rather we bring it with us, and dies with us. That is, it decomposes and disintegrates when our body decomposes after death. The exception to this is when the physical body is embalmed. The same thing with the previous body, the shadow or the chabit or the etheric body. It also decomposes within 3 to 6 days after death, except when the body is embalmed, then it lingers, it stays there. Then we come to another word used by the Egyptians, is the ba, or what we call the soul of man. It represents our soul. For the ancient Egyptians, it meant something like sublime, noble. The ba is not material, like the previous ones. It survives bodily death. In nature and substance, it was stated to be exceedingly refined. What is a mummy? A mummy is not a corpse, is not a cadaver. We have to remember that. A mummy is biologically dead, but stays alive on the psychic plane. In other words, the mummy is a psychic support and continues to exist as a condensation center for energy. This is why the mummies of advanced persons, saints, such as initiates or saints, have an unusual and extraordinary energy resting deeply in them as long as they resist decomposition. The mummy of a spiritually advanced person may become a path for those who want to communicate with higher spheres. After death, the ka of the initiate king stays in the tomb. That is the house of the ka, tied up with the ba, with the soul. In fact, they become one because the ka is pure. The ka, being pure and highly spiritual, continues to shine on earth as the soul, as a soul. In other words, it serves as a talisman or material basis for the manifestation of the soul upon earth. It can serve as a medium through which survivors can communicate and plead their cause with the beyond. The pyramid text of Saqqara express the eternal survival of the pharaoh. Even today, an interesting parallel to the talisman theory is that what the Catholic and Orthodox churches in many countries do. They display mummified parts or relics of former saints on holidays. Many miracles take place, as their remains are believed to be charged with a portion of their holiness. A contemporary example is found in Old Goa, G-O-A, a place in southwest coast of India. There, the remains of Saint Francis Xavier, the Jesuit missionary who died in India in 1552, are displayed in a glass coffin. At Bom Jesus Basilica, one by one, the Indian pilgrims touch the glass coffin, then kiss their hands. Some, hoping to be cured of disease, leave behind wax models of their inflicted parts as offerings. Many religious objects are sold around the church, including postcards showing St. Francis' remains with a note printed on them, stating that the postcards have touched the body. The body's incorruptibility or lack of decay following St. Francis' death was considered a miracle, which contributed to his canonization in 1622. Even Pope John Paul II visited the same church and kissed the coffin containing the remains of St. Francis last month. The second purpose of mummifying the initiate kings and priests had to do with reincarnation. If we look at the history of the world and the evolution of nations, we will discover a striking phenomenon. Evolution embraces one nation or two at a time. In other words, evolution on our planet does not embrace all mankind at the same time. we still have some people living a very primitive life. In other words, evolution does not embrace at the same time all the nations. For example, the Greeks were once the most advanced people in the world. Then came the Romans, then the Arabs, then the French, Spanish, German, etc., etc. This evolution of one nation after the other took place by reincarnation of the most advanced people from one nation to another. We read from Isis Unveiled the following. The astral soul of the mummy was believed to be lingering about the body for the whole space of the 3,000 years of the circle of necessity. 3,000 years. Thus, by mummifying their highly evolved souls, the Egyptians prevented the cycle of reincarnation from taking place in other nations, which would have in turn evolved. In other words, the Egyptians prevented the cyclic reincarnation of these souls in other nations by keeping them within their own nation. As a result, Egypt progressed without competition till the 3,000 years of cyclic incarnation was over. Subsequently, evolution was transmitted to other nations by reincarnation of these highly advanced souls in other nations. Egypt's history is demonstrated by the fact that its civilization survived exceptionally for 3,000 years. Nevertheless, the priests knew very well that mummification was not entirely effective in preventing reincarnation, as sooner or later, after a maximum period of 3,000 years, their initiate kings or priests would be reincarnated. The third opinion or third purpose of mummifying the initiate kings was that the ancient Egyptian priests decided to preserve their tradition through mummification of their initiates by presenting the possibility of discovering their knowledge in a new incarnation. Books and writings could be lost or altered. But by freezing the ka, or the double, of an initiate, they retained not only his memory, but his language, his culture, etc. When this ka will be reincorporated into a living man and brought into a new dynamic life, the lost knowledge will be discovered. Consequently, the famous ritual of the resurrection of the ka will come true. So this much about the mummification of initiate kings and priests. A time came, as mentioned before, when nobility and everyone who could afford it requested to be embalmed. It was then that the Egyptians developed a passion with death. They understood death as a desirable transformation, an inevitable transition that is entering into a great dream. In the metaphysical plane, the mummy was in a state of deep sleep or deep dream. The magician priests created, through the rituals, an artificial but almost a real paradise where the ka or the double experienced emotional joys which were more superior than when living on earth. But this paradise created by magic was not accessible to everyone. It required minute and correct observance of the rituals and a meticulously performed surgery, or rather, a ritualized surgery. That is, every process towards embalmment had a special ritual to be performed. Lengthy ceremonies were carried out during the whole period of 70 days of mummification by the uttering of words of power. It was called Hekau, by duly qualified men in a proper tone of voice to produce supernatural results. All these cost enormously. This is why only the rich could afford this paradise of dreams. This artificially created paradise had the mummies as support, helped by the deceased's memories, that is, his past, as well as his desires, his emotions, his feelings, even his fantasies. In other words, the mummy was a necessary support, that is, a psychobiologic medium for the ka or the double to survive. In the tomb, the specialized priest of the ka performed a ceremony of the most mysterious kind. The sarcophagus was kept standing, that is, the mummy was standing. On a table were placed strange instruments, such as the adze, a cutlass in the form of ostrich feathers, an artificial cow leg, a plate bearing the wajat eye, etc. There was also food and beer for the deceased ka. Incense was burnt, and the priest commenced the ceremony of the opening of the mouth of the ka. They recited the following. It will be given your two eyes to see, your two ears to hear what is said, your mouth for speech, your two feet for walking. You will move your two arms and two shoulders. Your flesh will be firm. Your muscles will be at rest, so that you may enjoy every limb of yours, so that you can count on all your limbs in complete and perfect health. At the end of the ceremony, it was the same priest endowed with clairaudience. Clairaudience means the faculty of hearing mentally. It's an exceptional insight, like clairvoyance. So it was the same priest endowed with clairaudience who could hear on ultrasound waves the answer of the fully equipped ka saying, "I am alive." It is important to know that our aura emanates very subtle sounds, which may be harmonious or chaotic. The sacred sounds or beautiful music are beneficial in bringing harmony into our aura as a whole. Evidently, we understand that it is not the mummy that is supposed to see, hear, talk, walk, etc., but the ka, as the whole ceremony was addressed to the ka. Once imprisoned in the tomb, the ka passes from the dynamic state to the static state. The ka will indefinitely dream of his past life. The dreams will consist of the scenes of his terrestrial life, which are painted on the walls of the tomb. The unparalleled and remarkably beautiful and breathtaking paintings of vivid colors on the walls of the tomb were not the dull and formal scenes of man meeting his God at the gates of heaven, but bright, happy pictures of banquet, fishing, hunting, sports, and scenes showing how the fields were tilled for sowing, and the grain was reaped, how the grapes were pressured for wine, scenes revealing craftsmen and artists at work with tools common to their period. Also displayed were gentle scenes of a man and his wife chatting with their children, scenes that related and depicted the events of the deceased's life. In one word, they were scenes that reflected the Egyptians' greatest wish that even after death, the pleasant and desirable things of life might always be enjoyed in the afterlife. For this reason, the tomb and its contents were of supreme importance. Thus, what they enjoyed and found pleasant in this life, they tried to take with them into the next by placing in their tomb elaborately carved furniture, statues, utensils, tools, beautiful vases, jewelry, gold platters, and even food. Let us see some of these furniture in some of these tombs and paintings. From the burial room of a lector, priest named Edi, 6th dynasty, that is 22nd century BC, consists of a large number of copper vessels. Two delicate wooden chests of two different types of wood, decorated and painted with beautiful and bright colors. Small collection of cosmetic objects, dated 1250 BC. A mirror made of bronze with a lotus-shaped handle. Next is a jewelry box decorated with inlaid ivory and an ointment container in form of lotus flower. The oldest harp ever existed. It dates over 3,600 years. Cosmetic ointment containers made of wood in the form of servants, male and female, carrying on their shoulder the receptacle of ointment. Another set of kohl, K-O-H-L, container, used as eyeshadow. Cosmetic spoon called the swimmer's spoon, dated 1400 BC, made of wood and ivory. The figure of a girl carved in wood holds a duck in her outstretched arms. The duck's hollowed out body contained cosmetic ointment. The articulated wings form the lid, now missing. The young girl is pushing the ivory-made duck in front of her. From the tomb of the nobleman Chi in the Old Kingdom, that is between 28 and 2300 years BC, 2300 BC, Chi himself watches the hippopotamus hunt taking place in the reeds. In the water, we see fish. A typical scene of daily life, a herdsman leading the cattle to water. Women working in the land owned by Chi bring forth the produce of the land. Carpenters at work. Construction of boats. These are all from the Old Kingdom. Scribes, proud professionals with simple tools. From the tomb of Akhethotep, reapers and flute players in the fields. From the tomb of Nikhet Efetka, 5th dynasty in Saqqara, we see a harpist. singers and dancers. Servants bringing various gifts. Here we see a cartouche in which mentions the name of the king Isi. It means that this was the time of the pharaoh Isi, 23rd century BC. Another group of servants bringing various gifts. Ptahhotep tomb showing beautiful cranes. Birds on acacia tree in the tomb of Khen-Emhotep, 12th dynasty, 18th century BC. Painting on limestone, the scene represents netting ducks in the marshes. The border of the net is shown above on the top right side, and the edge of the water on the right at the lower part of the scene. We see a beautiful acacia tree in flower and birds perching on it. Three shrikes, one red start, and a hoopoe. Mana's tomb. Mana is shown with members of his family on papyrus boats. On one side, he is killing a bird with a throw stick, while on the other side, he is spearing a fish. Below is the Nile, depicted by means of a zigzag pattern for water, teems with fish, water lilies, and ducks. The faces of some of the figures were deliberately obliterated in ancient time. Here is shown Neb-Amun, the owner of the tomb, with his wife and daughter sailing in the papyrus marshes in a light boat. He holds a throw stick, a cat on the left side, trained for the purpose, receives the smitten bird. The artist's skill is remarkable in portraying natural life by the lively representations of birds, insects, fish, and the cat. Mena's tomb, 14th century BC, the picture depicts reaping, winnowing, and paying tax. First row from the bottom, workers reap wheat with sickles and carry it in rope baskets to the threshold to be threshed. Middle row, the farmers winnow the wheat, tossing it up in scoops so that the wind will blow away the chaff. The winnowers have their head covered against the sun and dust. In a kiosk to the left stands Mena. Behind him are the subordinate scribes who record the yield. The top row, Mena appears again. He watches the farmers paying their taxes. Again, a scene of reaping, winnowing, and transportation by boat. From Neb-Amun's tomb, the cattle shown here may have belonged to him. Groups of cattle being herded before scribes who note down the numbers reported by the cattle attendants. In the same tomb, we see the seated guests who are served with wine, the band of musicians with dancers engage in rhythmic movements. The range of wine jars are kept cool with garlands. More guests at the banquet of Neb-Amun are shown here. In the upper row, men and women receive floral collars and wine. In the lower row, the guests are women who wear heavy wigs topped by lotus flowers and cones of perfumed ointment, which in the course of the banquet would melt and trickle down over the wigs and bodies. On the left are quantities of food and drink piled on and below tables. Jewelers at work The result of their work is displayed on each row. Dancers exhibit their acrobatic dances. Painted relief in the tomb of Amenherchesef in the Valley of the Queens. Tomb of Ramesses I in the Valley of the Kings. Tomb of Queen Nefertari, wife of Ramesses II. The ceiling in the tomb of Ramesses VI, the heavenly body of the sky, Nut, N-U-T, spans the ceiling. Her body represents the sun's path, artistically equated with the Milky Way, though Egyptian astronomers knew better. Egyptians invented the 24-hour day, but loving symmetry split it in half. Tomb of Senegem, a nobleman. The ceremony of the opening of the mouth in the tomb of Tutankhamun on the wall of the burial room. On the far left, we see the god Osiris embraced by Tutankhamun. Behind Tutankhamun is his Ka, having the symbol of Ka on his head. In the center is the goddess Nut, N-U-T, the goddess of sky or heaven, welcoming her son Tutankhamun. The same picture shows at the far right, King Ay, A-Y, Tutankhamun's successor and high priest, wearing leopard skin, holding the adze, and performs the ritual of opening of the mouth on Tutankhamun, who is represented as Osiris. Between Tutankhamun and Ay, we see a table on which are placed the adze, a cow's leg, as well as the cutlass in the form of ostrich feather. We see also, there is also on that table, the wedged eye, amulet for being healthy and safe. We also see this alabaster tablet naming the seven sacred oils. Again, when mummification became so common and requested by every Egyptian, the priests became alarmed and terrified. Here was a great danger. Not every embalmed person lived saint-like life. By mummification, the etheric body was perpetuated. The phantom or the shadow or the electric body was perpetuated and kept in existence for ages. And if the person lived a wicked life, dark forces or evil entities would enter into such an etheric body and use it as a distributing station for their evil intentions. This is the cause of the attacks and the disasters which pursue the steps of those who discover ancient tombs and brings mummies and their possessions into light. The same would happen with the Ka, or the astral body of a person who lived a wicked life. It would be used by astral entities or dark forces to mislead people in their dreams. And I would say this, it is not advisable to go to diviners, mediums, or psychics, not to put faith in apparitions or visions, because the dark forces can work by hiding themselves in the astral body of a dead person whose astral body has not yet disintegrated. This can mislead us by providing wrong information, impressions of fear, hatred, jealousy, and it may stimulate illusions. In the 6th century BC, the Iranian wise man Zoroaster said that the bodies at death become demons through their shadow, that is, through their etheric body. He forbade the embalmment of the dead because the embalmment prevented the disintegration of the shadow or the phantom, and recommended that the dead be left for the vultures to devour them. Of course, the opposite of mummification is cremation, which detaches the soul from all attachment to earth, whether etheric body or astral body, thus releasing the unfolding human soul and allowing it to proceed on its way towards higher realms. The French prolific writer L. Bernard, who writes about enigmas in the world, he says, it is suspected, not without logic, that the pharaonic civilization died because of Egyptians' dangerous custom of mummification. In the long run, the accumulation of, I'm continuing his quotation, in the long run, the accumulation of non-decomposed corpses aggravated by the violation of the tombs gave rise to an insidious atmosphere of spiritism and endangered the dynamism of the living. In other words, he wants to say that the mummification craze was the major cause of the end of Egyptian civilization. On the other hand, the tombs of the ancient Egyptians offer the most comprehensive record of life in pharaonic Egypt. They are storehouses of articles which clearly tell us how peoples of that magnificent civilization lived, what they ate, drank, what they believed, whom they worshipped, and most important, what they learned of life and the world in which they lived. From mummies, much can be learned about the physical appearance of the early Egyptians, their diseases, their lifespan, their knowledge and use of medicine, the techniques they used in mummification. Their faces revealed, old healed fractures, and even the age at death are still evident in the bones. The Egyptian Museum in Cairo preserves the largest collection of mummies in the world, and the only collection of royal mummies. This collection is actually an important source of historical information. To archaeologists, the tomb has become a museum preserving the history and culture of the ancient Egyptians. As for the mummies themselves, they are biological museums, worthwhile subjects of scholarly research, and a witness of the greatness and splendor of a magnificent and unparalleled civilization. And I would like to conclude my lecture by a quotation from Isis Unveiled. If our scientists are unable to imitate the mummy embalming of the Egyptians, how much greater would be their surprise to see, as we have, dead bodies preserved by alchemical art, so that after the lapse of centuries, they seem as though the individuals were but sleeping. The complexions were as fresh, the skin as elastic, the eyes as natural and sparkling, as though they were in full flush of health. And the wheels of life had been stopped but the instant before. Unquote. Thank you very much for your interest.
The land of mystery.